everyone, and welcome back to another episode of What's Cookin'. Today, we're gonna make a scrumdiddlyumptious recipe that I think you're gonna love. Not only because it's in the back of the book that I'm going to share with you today, but also because it happens to tie in perfectly with the library's 2021 winter reading theme. This year, our winter reading theme is read, read as fast as you can. You can't catch me, I'm the... Did you say gingerbread man? If you did, you were right. Our theme this year is gingerbread people, and you can print this bookmark off of this Snow Much Fun page of our library website, or you can swing by and pull into a curbside pickup spot here in the library, and a staff member will run them out to you. But the idea is to color in a gingerbread person for every 30 minutes that you read. You'll see I already have two colored in on my bookmark. I still have four more to go on the back. But once all your gingerbread cookies are colored in, you can turn this ticket in for a chance to win a $25 gift card. And that's happening the whole month of January, so I do hope that you'll participate. Now, back to those gingerbread cookies. Are you ready to share a story with me and then make some delicious gingerbread people to eat? Great. We're gonna read today Cynthia Ryland's The Cookie Store Cat. What I love about this book, besides the story itself, is at the back of it, it gives lots of cookie recipes that you could try at home with your family. It has the gumdrop gems, after school bachelor buttons, frosty fruit squares, cinnamon sugar plums, along with the gingerbread men. All right, let's get started. The Cookie Store Cat. There is a cookie store cat who spends his days in the most delicious ways. He sleeps in a little gray bed at the back of the cookie store, and each morning, around 6 a.m., the cookie bakers come to wake him and kiss him and tell him hello. They tell him he's sweeter than any cookie they have ever baked. They tell him he is prettier than marzipan, and they brag that he is their gumdrop gem. So their bakery shop has their own little kitten. It's like become their pet, right? They even made a little bed for it. One of the bakers found the cookie store cat many years ago. At 6 a.m., he was unlocking the door of his cookie store, as usual, when he heard a thin squeak behind him. He turned around and saw two big green eyes in the tiniest, skinniest, hungriest kitten's body. The old baker was a soft-hearted man, and he scooped the kitten up and carried him inside, where the bakers fed the kitten real cream and a bite of cookie dough. That day, they bought a bag of cat food and a little gray bed and a white dish that said kitty on it, and they made the cat their own. And now, after so many years, the bakers cannot remember ever being without the cookie store cat. He's just become part of the family, right? There you see his kitty bowl. And it looks like they already fattened him up, didn't they? He was a skinny, hungry stray cat until they took him in. And now it looks like he is full and warm. After the bakers give him his morning kisses each day, the cookie store cat rises up and stretches and rubs against the baker's legs as they whip up their orange and maple and mocha frostings. He purrs. He's a good cat, and he never jumps on their baker's table. That's probably a big no-no, right? Because you wouldn't want to get cat fur near the food. So he's a good cat and he listens, and he stays down there. Doesn't that sound delicious what the bakers are making? Orange, maple, and mocha frosting. Yum. In a little while, he lets himself out through the wooden screen door painted with cherry drops and gingerbread men, and he walks along the street saying good morning to all the storekeepers who come early to work. His favorite is the fish shop owner, of course. But he's also fond of the yarn lady and the model train man, and he very much enjoys the bookshop people. So he not only made friends with the bakers, who took him in as a pet, but he made friends with all the other storekeepers on the block. After his morning hellos, the cookie store cat returns to the place he loves best of all. He lets himself in through the wooden screen door and jumps up to the sunny window to sleep beneath his chocolate chip cookie sign. The cookie store cat has many friends. Every Monday of every week, Father Eugene stops by for a cup of Irish coffee and 3 Scotch chewies. He pets the cookie store cat and tells him all about the new baby in the parish, or the bingo game he called, or the old maple in the churchyard that needs pruning. The cookie store cat purrs. He's a good listener. So he has special weekly visitors that come to see him. After school every day, the children come. They carry the cookie store cat on their shoulders and they cradle him like a baby and pass him one to one, scratching the top of his head as they order up their caramel clusters and ginger creams, their bachelor buttons, and their frosty fruit squares. Those all sound delicious. So it seems like the cookie store cat now has a great life, right? He's warm and fed, and he also has all these friends and these special visitors who come to give him attention and to give him some love. The children sit outside the store with bags of cookies and boxes of milk, and the cookie store cat rubs his nose with theirs and bats at their pencils and licks drops of milk from their fingers. Christmas is the most wonderful time of all. The bakers wear aprons decorated with candy canes, and they fill their shelves with jingle bell puffs, snowballs, and chocolate Christmas bonbons. They give away free Santa Claus faces to every child, and the cookie store cat wears a big red bow every day in December, and the bell on it makes him jingle when he walks. He is so beautiful and jingles so nicely that he is the talk of the town. On Christmas Day, when the store is closed, the old baker, the one who found him, comes to have turkey dinner with him. Wow, he even shares his holiday meal with him. Winter passes, and spring, and summer, and fall, and the cookie store cat knows just where he belongs. At the end of each day, he knows that one of the bakers will fill a big bag of cookies to take to the children's home, and another will sweep up all of the crumbs from the floor, and another will wash the fingerprints from the cherry drops on the wooden screen door. They all work together, and they all have a special job, don't they? And I bet you they take turns with those jobs. He knows that the old baker, the one who found him, will lift up his favorite cat and kiss him and tell him he's sweeter than frosted cream, prettier than a sugar plum. The baker will put real cream in the white kitty bowl and will carry the cookie store cat to his little gray bed. Then the old baker and the other bakers will go home, shutting softly the door behind them, and the cookie store cat will sleep in sweet dreaming all night long. And then, of course, in the morning, the bakers will be back. And they'll start a new day of baking, won't they? And there's all those delicious recipes that I showed you at the start of the story. Today, we're making this one right here, Gingerbread Men. And a list of ingredients is also on the Snow Much Fun page of our library website. Okay, you're going to need flour and sugar, 1 egg, some vinegar, some cloves and cinnamon, and what else? Some nutmeg. So all of those ingredients are listed on a separate sheet that looks like this, printable from our website. I've also included some table talkers, some things that you could talk about in the kitchen as you bake or as you enjoy those cookies. Okay? All right, so I'm gonna give you a minute to gather all your ingredients, to wash your hands, of course, before we start. And I'll meet you back here in just a little bit to start baking those cookies. All right, welcome back, everyone. We are ready to start our baking. And as you can see, I've already measured out some of our ingredients. In this bowl, I have the cup of softened butter and my 1 cup of sugar. My butter sat out for a while so that it was soft. I still broke it into some pieces. I thought that would be easier to do or to help with the mixing process. So I broke it into some pieces here, some chunks. And now I'm gonna go ahead and take this electric handheld mixer and I'm gonna blend those two ingredients together, the butter and the sugar. Now, one thing that's important to remember if you're using a mixer like mine is that you wanna use the lowest setting so that the butter doesn't go splattering all over the kitchen, because that can make quite a mess and nobody likes cleaning up, right? For me, I love to bake, but I hate the cleanup part. All right, so you're just gonna mix this for however many minutes it takes until it is well blended. I think it's kind of fun to watch all those sugar granules kind of just disappear into that butter. You don't wanna see any of the grains of sugar left. You wanna make sure it's all creamed very well. So sometimes that might require spinning the bowl, right? Or moving the hand mixer around the bowl. You can't keep it just in one spot, or you're not gonna blend it well enough. And of course, as always, this requires a grown-up's help. So it's great if you're cooking today with mom or dad or grandma or grandpa, an aunt or an uncle, or maybe an older sibling is helping you out today. It's definitely more fun when you cook together anyway. So I always like to have company in the kitchen. All right, mine's getting fairly well blended here. I don't know if you can see that. I'm gonna keep going a little bit more just to make sure. And again, my mixer goes up to setting 5. Right now I am mixing on number 1, the lowest setting that there is. Okay. That looks pretty good to me. Okay, we can of course scrape that off of the mixers in just a little bit. But let's go ahead and add the rest of our wet ingredients. We need to add 1 egg. So you're gonna crack that egg on the table or on the side of the bowl, right? And then very carefully pull it apart so as not to try to get any of the shell inside. And that was a perfect break for me. Remember we talked on a couple of the other cooking shows that cracking an egg, that takes practice. So don't worry if sometimes you do get a little bit of shell in there. Sometimes it's tedious to pick out, but you could do it with a grown-up's help. Sometimes I get the corner of a paper towel and I just kind of, you know, fish it out with the paper towel. But the more you do it, the better you'll get. All right, so it needs 1 egg. It also needs 1 cup of molasses. I wonder if you've ever cooked with molasses before. It looks just like a heavy maple syrup, right? And it smells heavenly. I love the smell of molasses. I'm gonna go ahead and pour my entire 1 cup in there. And because it is so thick and sticky, you might need a spatula or a scraper or a spoon to help get out all that's in that 1 cup. You don't wanna waste any. You wanna make sure it all comes out. Okay, so I'll use my mixing spoon. If you have a scraper at home or a spatula or something that will work better, feel free to use that. And then the last wet ingredient that we have to add is 2 tablespoons of vinegar. Let's double check the recipe. I think it's 2 tablespoons. Yes, 2 tablespoons of vinegar. And that I do not already have measured out, so I will do that in front of you. You take your 1 tablespoon and a bottle of vinegar, and you're going to very carefully measure that out over top of the bowl. There goes 1. There goes 2. Ooh, that was a little bit more than 2. And that's always okay too. No worries. All right. And then I'm gonna go ahead and mix again. So back onto that low setting of number 1. Let's mix all 5 ingredients together now. Very quickly, you'll see that starts to change from a white or yellowish color to a very dark brown. And of course, that's because of the molasses that we just added. Sometimes you have to scrape the side of the bowl. And again, you might have to use that spoon or that spatula to help you scrape and get what's on the left or what's on the sides of the bowl. You don't want to leave that in there. So scrape it down in the mixture. And again, this might take 1 to 2 minutes because you want to make sure it's fully blended. So as long as it takes, just be patient. When your arm gets tired, that's when you pass it to another family member and let them take their turn. Okay, once we think that is fully blended, and I feel like mine is, we can go ahead and turn our mixer off again. And now add our dry ingredients. And our dry ingredients was 4 or 5 cups of flour, right? Our nutmeg, our cinnamon, our cloves, salt, and baking soda, which you didn't need a lot of, but those really are key ingredients. So you want to make sure you have those two things as well. Mine's already measured out in this bowl, but I didn't sift it yet. So I'm going to go ahead and take my spoon. I don't have a clean one. That's okay. It's all going in together. And I'm going to sift those ingredients together, all my dry ingredients. We only added a couple teaspoons of the spices, right, to 5 cups of flour. So that's a big difference. So you really want to make sure you're sifting and stirring and getting those well blended. Once it is blended, then you can slowly begin to add the dry ingredients to the wet ingredients. And it is important to go a little bit at a time because that makes mixing much more easy. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and pour a little bit of the flour mixture into the butter and sugar mixture. You can keep on using the electric mixer, or you can stir by hand. If you feel like using those muscles, go ahead and stir by hand. If you have the mixer handy, or maybe you do a combination of both, right? I'm going to blend a little bit in. And then I'm going to blend a little bit more in. And I'm going to keep doing that until all of my flour mixture is gone from this bowl and has been transferred into this bowl. Right? So again, you see that white on top, and then you keep mixing until you see it turn brown. You get that brown color in there. It's starting to look like gingerbread. It's starting to look like the dough that we need. I'm going to go ahead and add the rest of it. Again, making sure to get all of it. Okay. And let's mix again. Wonder, boys and girls, if you've ever made gingerbread cookies before. Or any other kind of cookie. Do you have experience in the kitchen with that? Are you guys already pro cookie bakers? If so, I think that's great. And if this is your first time, I think that's great too. Wonder if any of you wear an apron when you bake, if you have a special apron like I do today, or maybe even a chef's hat. Don't forget, I always love to see pictures of you guys cooking and baking in the kitchen. So if you ever want to share a picture with me, you can email it to me at volpee@einetwork.net because I always love to see what you're cooking up and the fun that you're having together. All right, enough with the mixer. I'm going to go ahead and now mix with my spoon. And of course, like we said earlier, I will scrape this dough off of the mixers and get all that goodness in there as well. Once it is fully mixed,
by mixer, by spoon, by hand, because don't forget, you can get your hands dirty and you can start kneading the dough by hand too. That's what I did when I made my batch last night. Definitely get your hands in there. It's fun to play with it, kind of like Play-Doh, right? But anyway, once it's fully formed into a dough mixture, then you have to chill it in the refrigerator for 3 hours before you can roll it out and start making your cookies. Okay, so that chilling time is important too. You have to be patient and you have to stick it in there for 3 hours or so. That's why I made my dough last night and have a batch already ready to go. Okay, so for the sake of time, my friends, I would keep mixing this. I don't know if you can see in the bowl. I think you can. It's not, you can still see white. You can still see flour. So it's not quite blended. I would keep stirring if I was at home in my kitchen. And I would scrape these mixers and get that in there too. Okay, for the sake of time, I'm going to move this aside and just pretend that I've already done that. We're going to take out the dough that I made last night. Looks like this, like a great big mud cake, right? This color brown, it kind of looks like mud. This is my dough, and now I'm ready to roll it. So you see that I have a floured surface here. Your dough is going to be sticky, so it helps if you flour the surface that you're rolling on, whether that be a table, a counter, or a cutting board. Okay, you can go ahead and kind of press your dough down, and then you can start to use your rolling pin to roll out your dough. And this part's a lot of fun too. And it does work those muscles. Sometimes you can sing a song if you'd like. Roll, roll, roll the dough, roll as long with me. Right, make up your own song as you go. Roll it long, roll it flat, roll along with me. Again, because I'm cooking down here in the BPTV studio and not in my own kitchen, sometimes I have to improvise and sometimes it's harder. If I had a larger surface, if I had a big kitchen table or a counter, this would make rolling a lot easier. Okay, I would have to roll it all the way flat before I started to cut out my cookies. So again, we might not have time to do that or for me to show you that part on the show. But you know what I'm talking about. You know when you're at home doing it, you have to take your time. You have to really roll the dough out long and flat. Okay? And if you have to keep adding flour, my friends, you can do that. Sometimes you have to keep adding flour so it doesn't stick to your rolling pin like it just did for me. Okay? Again, let's just pretend that my dough is all rolled out and it's ready to go. Let's take a gingerbread man cookie cutter and let's see what that part is like. Your cookie cutters might look different than my cookie cutters. I have a big gingerbread man and I have a little gingerbread man. So I might make some of each. But you simply push down on the dough and your shape will pop right out and it'll look just like that, right? So there's a daddy one or a mommy one. Let's do a baby one. The baby one out. Ta-da! There's a baby one. This recipe is going to make about 60 cookies, but again, remember, it depends on the size that you're doing, that you're using. But it will make approximately 60 cookies. So you can make a whole gingerbread man family. Wouldn't that be fun? I think decorating is the best part. You're going to put them on a greased, oh, it should tell you, is it greased or ungreased? You're going to put it on a greased cookie sheet. And you're gonna pop it in the oven and bake it for only 5 to 6 minutes. That's the other cool thing about these cookies. They don't take very long to bake. And then when they come out, the most fun part, in my opinion, is the decorating. What could you use to decorate your gingerbread cookies? What could you use for the eyes and the nose and the mouth? Do you have any ideas? What about raisins? And if you were going to put raisins in for the eyes, you could put those in right now and bake them in the oven. But if you were going to use, let's say, chocolate chips for the eyes and the nose and the mouth, would you want to put them in the oven and bake it? Why or why not? What are you thinking at home? You guys are all so smart. You probably don't want to put chocolate in there before you bake, because what's going to happen in the hot oven? It's going to melt, right? And then that might spread and they're not going to look like eyes anymore. The whole mouth is going to blend together. So you don't want to bake the chocolate. If you're going to use chocolate chips, my friends, you want to wait until the cookies come out of the oven. Then you can press them in while they're still soft. Or even wait until they're entirely cool and use a little bit of icing to stick them in place. That's typically what I do. But let's talk about other ideas. You can use chocolate chips. You could use raisins or craisins. What else could you use for the face and then for the buttons if you wanted to add buttons? I know, there's lots of things we could use, right? You could use sprinkles. You can, of course, use icing, tubes of icing, maybe to make, you know, little squigglies around the gingerbread hands and feet as you typically see. Wouldn't it be fun to try to decorate a gingerbread person for every member of your family? Right, so I have curly black hair. Maybe I would use black icing and make curls on mine. Wouldn't that be fun to try? All right, no matter what you do, they're gonna taste delicious no matter what they look like. They're gonna be so scrumdiddlyumptious. I hope you had fun making them. I hope you enjoy eating them together, and I hope you will I hope you will join me again real soon on another episode of What's Cookin'. Remember, all of these episodes can be found on the Snow Much Fun page of the library website. Okay, everyone, have fun in the kitchen, and until next time, bye-bye.